Hello everyone, I'm quite nervous to be talking here, but I'm also really excited. Thank you for giving me this space to talk about myself and what the group analysis program means to me. Just to tell you a little bit about myself, I've been practicing as a psychotherapist for the last 4 years. I'm in my intermediate year in group analysis training. I got curious about group work during my master's course when we had the group therapy paper. However, the way I learned to practice group work was more like therapy to an individual in the group. I felt like it wasn't using the dynamics of the group to its potential. Like I had read in my textbooks that group is a microcosm of the society. I don't think I experienced the depth of that statement till I joined the group analysis course. I've also been training to be a transactional analyst for around 5 years now. What is interesting for me is that transactional analysis originated in the context of group work. However, currently, group work is not the mode of practice for many transactional analysts in India. I was curious to learn more about group therapy, but was disappointed to know that there was lack of experienced practitioners in my country. Fortunately, Hank Nunn, Bangalore, in collaboration with IGA London, had plans to bring the training to India, and I was excited to join the course. Now, I would like to share a little bit more about my experience in the program. Before the program, my approach to psychotherapy was to hold the individual responsible. Even though I knew that this approach was lacking because it didn't include the socio-political context, I didn't know any other way than to hold the individual responsible. So I am glad to be integrating the context into my work. My fears of investing in a program mostly run by staff who are not Indian has been that they wouldn't get the Indian context, or worse, they might pathologize my Indian clients. However, this course has been refreshing because it has its own structure and curriculum. But we are also encouraged as a cohort to suggest reading material that includes the Indian context. It's also heartwarming to know that my supervisor and therapist take the responsibility of keeping themselves informed. Due to the program's influence, I noticed changes in the nature of my experiences. Just to give you an example, to be able to move away from my fears and insecurities and to be responsible in relationships. This is also why I am able to be here and talk today. I am really scared of large groups of people. With a huge demand and lack of effective therapists, a rigorous course such as this is important in India, and also that there are no other courses that I'm aware of which trains in group work. I would also like to add that I started conducting a group in my private practice this January. This was only a dream of mine, but now a reality. I'm enjoying conducting this group and look forward to conducting many more. Thank you for supporting and making this program accessible to us.
Thank you, Vaaruni.
Thank you, Farhad. And thank you so much, everybody, for turning up. And I'm especially grateful to Vaaruni for that wonderful introduction, and certainly whetted my appetite to know much more about the course and the training. So I'm trained as a forensic psychiatrist and also as a therapist. And for most of my working life, I've been working as a therapist with offenders. But I trained as a group analyst about 20 years ago. And I want to share with you some ideas about how group work might be particularly helpful for offenders. So, I think that's going to work. I'm hoping that you can see that. All right. Is that okay? Can you see that?
Yes.
Cool. Thank you very much. And I'm just going to start from the beginning. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk my way through these slides, which I hope will then be a kind of springboard for discussion later on. And I'm very interested in what people have to say and people's associated thoughts. And this is very much based on my work in as a group therapist in high secure hospitals, but also in prisons, and also working with other co-therapists and other supervisees in prisons. And I do want to acknowledge straight away that this kind of work can't be done on your own. It's very much work that one does as a team with other people. So that group approach is really important, and we might want to come back and talk about that. So I want to start by thinking a little bit about what it is to be prosocial and antisocial, and which I think will take us a little bit into the social realm, the idea of the social mind and the social context in which we live and move and have our being, in that famous quote. And I want to think about how group work might be able to help people be more prosocial. So I just want to start by thinking about us as group animals, and I'm very grateful to the Cave family for letting me share a photograph of one of their family celebrations, just as an indication of a particularly large, happy family group. But also this lovely picture of Japanese monkeys, just to remind ourselves that it's part of our mammalian heritage to be in groups. Like other non-human primates, we live in groups of varying sizes, and being excluded from groups often results in various kinds of deprivation and death. And indeed, isolate animals, usually rogue males, are often treated with suspicion and isolation by the other groups, by the other group members. And this social mind, this social attachment, is really linked with a kind of development of a social brain. So some of you may have come across the work of Robin Dunbar, who talked about how our need to live in groups drove the evolution of cortical size, the neocortical size in humans. And the volume of our neocortex is proportionate to group size. And this enables, it makes possible a social brain where there's a capacity to live in socially complex and diverse relationships. And that social mind includes a capacity to mentalize other minds. Just excuse me while I get rid of my cat. So, in terms of when we think about social complexity, we're thinking, of course, about not just group size, but also the level of intimacy that groups form with each members. We might also think, of course, about groups in terms of where we meet potential peers and friends and mating strategies. Groups may also use tactical deception, both inside groups and outside of groups. But perhaps one of the most important complexities of living in a group is our capacity to read other minds, or to think about the reality of other minds, what has been called this capacity for mentalizing, the making inferences about other people's intentions. And the reality of other minds is something I'm going to come back to, because it's something that I think that many people that I work with really struggle with. But something about our enhanced neocortices, the size of our neocortices, allows us this capacity to make inferences about other people's minds, to almost be able to read, if you like, the cues of others and to think about them. And I think that our connection with other non-human primates makes me think that our social identity is really primary. It comes about from our attachment to groups. It's only by being part of a group that our individual identity can emerge in that context. And we need, as individuals, to make different kinds of relationships work in those group contexts. We need to be able to make friends and allies, we need to be able to play, we need to be able to find mates, we need to be able to manage conflicts, we need to belong, in groups and have an identity alongside that group, but also have identities that are different from those groups and also perhaps change groups over time. So it seems to me that, you know, that our group identities are fundamental to how we do human consciousness and how we do identity. I think that one of the things that's really very interesting about human groups is when they're working well, they are flexible and enable that figure ground dynamic of individual and group identities to be a living, dynamic, organic kind of process. And I think that it's also interesting to consider how in human groups we're able to have a flexibility between top-down models of relating, kind of hierarchical models of relating, perhaps particularly when we're anxious, and more radial, flattened ways of relating across the group in cooperative ways, and being able to make that flexibility, those moves between the top down and the more radial, is part again of our ability to use groups and live and work and play and be in groups. And the really interesting thing, of course, about human beings is that although we share 98% of our genetic material with non-human primates, there are remarkable and very substantial differences between us. And oh, what a difference 2% makes. And that 2% difference gives us the capacity for language. It gives us the ability to, it gives us the actual physiological structures that make that possible. And of course, with language comes we don't no longer need to be in physical contact with people. And of course, we've seen that dramatically in the last couple of years. Of course, language evolves to convey more complex communications, and it allows relationships to develop and exist over time and in memory. Language often also allows for widely different kinds of social interaction relationships. It allows for the communication of emotions, again, crucial to different kinds of relationships, especially intimate relationships. And of course, we need language for storytelling. We are storytelling animals, but in order to tell stories, we need language and symbolic function. And the reason I'm laboring this a little bit is because I hope to show you that these are the kind of things that the people I work with often struggle with. We'll come back to talk about that a bit more. But this is Robin Dunbar's idea that language evolved to replace the grooming, which in other non-human primates is the matrix for relationships. But of course, we use language to create our matrices, language and presence and relationship. And that becomes, again, an important part of our attachments to groups, but also our social identities. So I want now to just think a little bit about what it means to be antisocial. So if we assume that we all have a capacity to have a social brain and a social mind, and that's crucial to our identity, what does it mean to be in a kind of antisocial state of mind? So one aspect of the antisocial state of mind is going to be around rule breaking. Because many rules involve agreements between individuals that often contribute quite strongly to groups. And the most obvious example of this is playing any kind of game. A game is only possible. The formalities of a game are only possible because there are rules that then define the game and allow it to emerge into existence. And it's only by having those rules that actually the players of the game know what it is that they're doing and know perhaps particularly what they shouldn't be doing or can't be doing. And of course, in human life, we take that extremely seriously, and playing of games and team games or individual games has, of course, been known for thousands and thousands of years. And rules in order to play with one another pro-socially, absolutely crucial to that. And people who are in antisocial states of mind don't do rules. And people who are in antisocial states of mind often make attacks on the groups that they might otherwise belong to. So it's very common, for example, for people who steal, to steal from people local to them, and to feel no sense of connection with their local communities. There's, of course, much more to be said about theft, which, interestingly, the commonest type of crime, I don't know whether this is the case in India, but it's certainly the case in Europe, the commonest types of crime are variations on the theme of taking other people's stuff. And what's interesting about that is that there seems to be a lack of a sense of connection between the person who is doing the stealing and the person who's having their stuff stolen. It's as if the person who's doing the stealing doesn't feel any connection with the group to which they both belong, or indeed how they would feel with if their stuff was stolen. And there's often associated with that a kind of distancing from the group that they come from, its language and its customs. And there may be a rejection of attachments to other people and groups of other people. So it's not uncommon in the world that I work in to meet men and women who have committed themselves to a kind of antisocial life in which they don't really connect with other people at all. They don't have friends. They often don't have families. They might belong to gangs, but that belonging, that attachment is often quite unstable and often quite a paranoid attachment. So social isolation is a key feature of the antisocial state of mind, and we'll come on to talk a bit more about that later, perhaps. The other thing about being in an antisocial state of mind is that it actually places you in danger. From other people. People who are regularly antisocial will be expelled by the groups to which they belong, and they won't be protected or welcomed by those groups. And they're likely to be attacked by other groups of people and to die earlier than those who have some kind of social attachment. And this is all true, of course, of offenders. So most offenders are people who are rejected, who are expelled from their groups. They're not offered protection or welcome. They're often highly stigmatized and seen as being a danger to the groups that they used to belong to. And they definitely have poor physical and mental health and tend to die earlier, not just by suicide, although suicide risk is higher in antisocial groups than in the general population, but actually poor physical and mental health generally. And what's intriguing about this is that actually this is also true of studies done in group animals such as rhesus monkeys. You may or may not know that for the last 70 years or so, there have been primates laboratories in the States and in the Netherlands that have done really, really interesting work on the social lives of monkeys and bigger apes. And what is very remarkable is about the complexity of those social lives and how monkeys who are antisocial get excluded from their groups. They're not popular with other monkeys. And Steve Suomi is now retired, used to work in the primate lab in Maryland. And he was particularly interested in the genetics of attachment to groups and in social rule breaking. And he published a very interesting study of antisocial monkeys. Some monkeys seem to be more impulsive and seem to break these group rules, and they would get excluded from their troops because they broke the rules. And if they got excluded, nobody would play with them or groom with them or mate with them. And if they got into a conflict with more senior monkeys higher up the hierarchy, they often got severely attacked. And intriguingly, because they're very impulsive, they die early because of poor judgment of tree distance. And Suomi's group identified a particular genetic vulnerability in this group, which is interesting because it's not dissimilar from a genetic vulnerability that we find in man. But the really intriguing thing is that there's a very strong interaction between the genetic vulnerability and an early rearing experience. So the better your early rearing experience, the less likely that you are to have this kind of genetic vulnerability expressed. And we can come back to talk about that later if you like. In terms of stories, I mentioned narratives and stories, and some of you may have come across a very nice book by Christopher Booker called The Seven Basic Plots. And this is an old idea that actually when it comes to telling human stories is actually quite a limited number of stories that human beings tell across the world, across history, across cultures. You tend to find the same themes coming up again and again. And one of the themes that Christopher Booker identified was the idea of the dangerous individual who poses a risk to the community, and how this kind of dangerous individual is blind to the connection to groups that they belong to, and how those rule breakers can cause disorder in communities, and how often the hero of these stories is sets off to overcome the monster that's threatening the life of the community, and how people are changed during their quests, and how often they have to leave their communities of origin to travel, and in their traveling, in their journeys, they're transformed, and that allows them to come back and rejoin their communities in different ways. And this theme about narratives of identity and community and how they might change across a lifespan, and how things go wrong for people who leave their communities and don't feel alienated in the communities, again, is a very old and ancient and thought-provoking theme. But of course, it's massively politically complex. And I'm sure I don't need to tell you that one of the pervasive dilemmas for all of us who work in mental health, all of those who study psychiatry and psychological therapy, which often have implicit and explicit ideas about norms, raise very interesting questions about to what extent someone who's antisocial is breaching social norms in a way which is actually not necessarily something bad. I mean, the community might think it's bad, but actually ideas of badness are themselves quite complex. And this idea that people who are seen as dissenting, people who are standing up against a kind of group that is embodying cruelty or harmfulness or exploitation, that if you stand up against that, then you'll be seen as antisocial. And how do you distinguish between dissent and deviance and being purely antisocial and destructive? And this is a massive, massive issue. When does being prosocial become kind of colluding with something that which is harmful to human beings, and who gets to decide? And I think Fuchs was very aware of this, not least of all, in terms of his own history of fleeing a society that was grotesquely persecutory and in which individual rights were being written off and ignored, and that people who helped those people who were seen as deviant or antisocial were themselves deemed to be antisocial. So I don't want to suggest to you for a moment that the discourse of being antisocial and prosocial is simple or straightforward, and that's certainly not the position that I take. But when it comes to working in forensic settings, we work pretty much, the offenders that we work with are people who've broken the criminal law. And in general, I would say the vast majority of people who get group therapy at all, and it's not huge numbers of them, but those that do tend to be people who've breached the criminal law in violent ways and who've caused direct physical harm to other people. But again, we might like to come back and have a think about that later. I just want to talk a little bit more about attachment and groups. Again, this is one of Harry Hart, from one of Harry Harlow's original studies. Harry Harlow set up the Primate Lab in Maryland, and it was his work with on social relationships between rhesus monkeys in the 1960s that was a great influence on John Bowlby and Mary Ainsworth. So as I've said, attachment to groups is a really crucial aspect of how we develop our identity across the lifespan. We know that children are aware of attachment, attachment bonds from about 6 or 7 months. That is to say, they can reliably distinguish between their people and strangers from about 6 or 7 months. So it's very common for 6 or 7 month old babies to express alarm in the face of a stranger, but it doesn't happen much before 6 months, but about six or seven months is the usual time that begins to emerge. And that's an indication that a small child, a baby, is aware of belonging, of the people I belong to and the people I don't know, which is a very significant kind of first step. And most studies of attachment behavior rely on the fact that an attachment bond is kind of measurable from about a year or 18 months. And as you probably know, a lot of the studies of attachment in humans have been longitudinal developmental studies which have looked at attachment in 18-month-olds and toddlers, and then followed up those toddlers into adulthood. These are studies of personality going back now 30 years. So, for example, there's been a study been going in Minnesota, which has been looking, following up a cohort of babies, measuring their attachment at 18 months and following them up. And again, you probably know that when you're looking, studying attachment security can be rated in terms of either being secure or insecure. And what's interesting about that is that we know that individual insecurity tends to affect people's capacity to attach to groups. And I guess one of the interesting things is whether, if you struggle to attach to social groups, whether that also affects how you attach to your family groups. And there's lots, of course, of stories about people who've been excluded from their social groups of origin and had to make new lives and new attachments. These are the stories of migration in particular. And some very interesting sort of interdynamics between family group security and social group security. And a reasonably substantial literature about attachment in groups and its importance to how groups work. Attachment security has a strong relationship with good enough personality function in adult life. That is to say, the more secure your attachment in childhood, the better your personality function is going to be in young adulthood and later on. And we have very solid kind of longitudinal prospective studies that show that personality dysfunction is associated with insecure attachment. The disturbances of that early attachment bond interfere with your capacity to mentalize other people's minds, and that has a knock-on effect on your social function. And just to flag up too, that our attachment system is live until life's end, where we continue to make attachments throughout our lives. Our brains are active and plastic in this regard. And people's capacity to make attachments is a really important aspect of our evaluation, our assessment of them. And of course, we know this when we're assessing people to come into groups. So I mentioned mentalizing, and I just want to say a bit more about that. I'm very grateful to a friend of mine who went to a zoo recently and took this marvelous picture of a ringed lemur. And I just thought it was marvelous because I am confident that all of you looking at this picture are mentalizing that animal's emotion. Even though we don't know anything really about how primates like this do emotions, although we think they do emotions. But it's almost impossible to see a face like this without making inferences about a state of mind. And what that person, what that animal might be thinking or feeling. And I just thought it was a beautiful example of that. And just for those of you who haven't come across this notion before, it's mentalizing is about this concept of having mind in mind. And it's not so much a skill, although sometimes you will hear people talking about people having mentalizing skills, but it's actually better to think of it as a continuing process. It's a continual process. We're doing it all the time. We're always making inferences about other people's states of mind and their intentions towards us. And we're scanning for threat, of course, but we're also looking for connection and the development of trust. And what Peter Fonagy and Patrick Leuthen in Belgium have talked about is how our attachments and our mentalizing are linked, that in early childhood, a secure attachment allows us to mentalize more accurately. And if we can, the more accurately we can mentalize other people and have that sense of them having minds like us, the more we can build up what Peter Fonagy has called epistemic trust. And this is not just kind of regular basic trust. This is a trust that says that I can, what other people have to say to me, I can place reliance on. I can trust that when they speak to me, it has personal significance for me that I can learn from. So epistemic trust is very much about how we learn from other people. And that, of course, is you know, crucial to those attachment relationships in childhood and then later attachment relationships with friends and family and with partners. And this is another reason why people with insecure childhood attachments tend to struggle, not only with peer relationships in adulthood, but also with making intimate and emotional relationships. And we have good quality evidence that people who struggle in close intimate relationships often have histories of insecure childhood attachment insecurity. So I've already touched on this, but just to say that we know that people with insecure attachment systems don't mentalize very well and they struggle with trust. But in particular, what they really struggle with is emotional arousal. So if they start to feel wound up in the presence of other people, they can't use their mentalizing to contain themselves and self-soothe. And so they tend to become concrete and rigid thinkers who are very focused on action, rather than symbolizing in what people might mean. And I hope you can see straight away that that's a link, obviously with the language on defenses that we're all so familiar with from the psychodynamic training, but also about how important acting out might be for people who are in antisocial states of mind who can't mentalize. And this beautiful image from John Borman's film is just very potent and I think in poignant depiction of what it is to be alone and antisocial. There's a kind of isolation that comes with antisocial, which is more, I think, than just being a rule breaker and unpopular with others. There's something about a kind of exclusion, which is very important. And that's certainly a key issue for the people that we work with in prisons and secure psychiatric units. So just to tell you a little bit about some of the research that there's been about attachment insecurity and antisocial states of mind. John Bowlby is in fact one of the first people to have written about this. Freud did publish a paper about criminality, which was to do with a kind of unconscious sense of guilt. But Bowlby was one of the first people to suggest that young people who are convicted of theft might be acting out an absence, might be acting out their emotional experience of deprivation, and that their acting out was a substitute displacement for the deprivation they had suffered at home, that kind of concrete acting out that I was just referring to. And a lot, many, many other studies, too many to tell you all about in a talk like this, but I hope you will take it on trust that there we have good quality information that suggests that attachment insecurity is a risk factor, only one of many, but it's a risk factor of violence to others. And that's often because attachment insecurity is associated with avoidance of neediness and vulnerability, avoidance of reaching out to other people, sometimes denigration of vulnerability and need, an emphasis on strength and independence, and not needing to reach out, no need to connect to other people. So having said this, then I've already touched on this, that the people in antisocial states of minds tends to cause significant problems for other people, because they're kind of attacking the social groups to which other people belong. And so they often have a very poor history of attachments in their own family groups. And of course, that's often transgenerational. So you often find that people who have committed lots of offences come from families where they've had parents who also committed offences and were antisocial and spent time in prison. And one of the sad things is that when antisocial folk do manage to attach to others, it's often in a rather incoherent way with other similarly antisocial people. And those attachment bonds are often highly unstable and incoherent and don't do the job of providing safety and security and emotional containment that all of us need at times of stress. So one of the big problems that people who are in antisocial states of mind face is that they really struggle to manage stress, and they often lack the language to express that. I'm sure some of you may be wondering whether there's ever been times when being antisocial is actually effective for people. And of course, we might again think about the kinds of political discourse when there are people who break the rules in order to benefit themselves as other people, at other people's expense. We might also think about social groups that have antisocial values. So one thinks here about organized crime. And you may or may not know that the highest rates of homicide in the world are in countries whose social and political economies are run on the back of illegal drugs, mainly cocaine. So the highest rates of homicide in the world, far, far higher than anything that happens in Europe and even in America, are in Honduras and Belize and Venezuela, countries where there is a massive, massive illegal drugs trade. And there are great, great groups of people who make that trade happen, but with a knock-on effect of significant social violence. So, and of course, at this time, we are particularly thoughtful about nations who, as a large group, are organizing themselves into a kind of antisocial state of mind. I think North Korea comes to mind most obviously, but clearly one wonders about the state of mind of the president of Russia at present. People who are in antisocial states of mind tend to use a range of defenses. The criminal behavior itself is sometimes seen as a defense. This was John Bowlby's original idea. And that is an idea that's very strong in forensic psychotherapy, that the criminal behavior itself has meaning and reflects something about the offender's internal world. But most offenders tend to use the kind of psychological defenses that distort reality. So we see a lot of projection. We see splitting and sadomasochism, which are really two sides of the same coin. We see this very interesting rapid and unstable oscillations between idealization and devaluation, and similarly with omnipotence and passivity. Denial, of course, is a reality distorting event defense, which a lot of offenders use. Rationalization is a defense. And identification with the aggressor, very, very common in offenders who've experienced lots of childhood abuse and adversity. So just to run you through what some of the criminological risk factors for violence are, we know that being young and male are massive risk factors for violence. And this is clearly a kind of socio-cultural level. Why men are the majority of violence perpetrators is a $64,000 question. But my friend Jim Gilligan in the States has argued very strongly that this must be related to shame-based accounts of masculinity, where you aren't really a man unless you are inflicting violence on somebody else. And if somebody inflicts violence on you, you are ashamed and you are not really a man anymore. And that kind of shame-based masculinity is closely associated with violence, says Jim Gilligan. Social isolation is well known as a risk factor for violence, as well as a risk factor for poor physical and mental health. Diagnoses like antisocial personality disorder, I won't say very much more about this because antisocial personality disorder is really not a diagnosis as such, but a description of a behavior and a state of mind. But it's really just describing people who live in antisocial ways. But what is interesting is that a lot of people who are offenders misuse substances, are addicted to a range of substances. And this is almost certainly related to their inability to manage their emotions. They can't self-soothe, so they reach for substances to help manage any distress or painful emotions like fear or anger or rage. But the trouble is that substance misuse is a massive reality distorting defense, and significantly, highly significantly increases your risk of acting violently because your reality is distorted. And I've already touched on attachment insecurity and dysfunctional defenses. So as I've said, when an individual is violent, this often leads to his, and I'm going to refer to them as him because that's 95% of violent offenders are male. I can say something about women later on if you like. But these are men who are socially excluded, they're expelled, they're excluded. They're rejected, they're highly stigmatized, their group identity is spoiled. That's the meaning of the word stigma. And often it is shattered forever so that they can't ever return to the community. And there are particular offenses which make it very difficult for people to return to community. Homicide is one, but the abuse of children is another. The courts interpret violent acts as a communication to the group as a whole, to the social group as a whole. And criminal courts exist to represent the views of the group as a whole, as a group, as a community. When a criminal trial takes place, the court is representing us, and the jury is representing us. And when violence is done, it's done to the group as a whole, not just to an individual. And that's the basis of law in this country and in the States and in Australia and New Zealand, that kind of jurisprudence where violence is a social act. And we can think about different kinds of violence. There's violence that's instrumental, and as for example, an armed robbery where you might use violence in order to get the robbery done. That would be violence which is not, where you don't necessarily intend to do harm, physical harm to others, but you need to use the violence in order to get your job done. That kind of instrumental violence. Tend to see that more in things like armed robbery. Of course, there's violence that we might deem to be political violence, and that we see that in people convicted of terrorist offences. They are people who are not often offered psychological treatments, and we might want to think about that. Most violence perpetrators that I'll be working with are people who've been convicted of relational violence, so violence to partners, to children, to family members, to peers, and where that violence seems to be hard to manage. I don't know if you will think this is amusing or interesting, but this is the reason I put it up here is because a lot of groups for offenders really focus around the idea that an offender is operating in a very particular time and context and place. So this Christmas group therapy joke is about the fact that there is a group of individuals who are meeting in a very particular context. Their context is what causes them the problem. And those of us who work as psychotherapists with offenders, I think, are always mindful of the fact that we're only meeting people because we're in a very particular social context. They come into our prisons, they come into our psychiatric units because they've done something terrible and frightened other people. And we have to meet them in that context, in this very particular chapter of their lives. This is particularly true for people who've killed, which is a group that I've done quite a lot of work with. And these are people for whom one life is over, and another life is about to begin. And this idea of being stuck in a very particular context for your offending, a very particular social context, a very particular social identity, I think is really important when we come to think about group therapy for offenders. So in terms of the history, I've already mentioned thinking about this, so thinking about whether you could treat people who have a criminal who've committed offences. This first paper by Freud in 1912, Bowlby in 1944. But this really gets going in the 1960s and 70s as people start to get interested in rehabilitation of criminals and also start to see them as individuals as well as products of their society. And in the 1960s, you begin to get this dialogue between the individual and the society and to think about rehabilitation. So there were studies about criminal thinking and mental health. And in both the United States and in the UK, group therapy began to start in some prisons. So HMP Grendon, which has an ongoing therapy community, has been in business for over 50 years. So this is the question, really, for therapists or anybody wanting to start up a group for offenders is how do we make, could groups help people to be more pro-social? And how would you go about doing that? How would you use group analytic ideas to develop a kind of pro-social kind of stance? How could you use groups to help people examine their antisocial state of mind and perhaps transform it or reform it into a more pro-social state of mind? And you know, there are all sorts of questions about this. Is it about process? Is it about technique? And this, for me, has raised much more basic questions about what changes anybody's mind for the better. And you know, why would we think that groups might help people be more pro-social? So, I mean, one of the obvious answers might be that group therapy for offenders gives a place for a person to reconnect, that the first step in becoming less antisocial is to be social and to connect to a group of other people. But people who've gotten to very antisocial states of mind may find it hard to give them up. And we do run groups, and groups are run in all sorts of forensic settings, and we do get people who break the rules because they're accustomed to breaking the rules. They find it hard to feel a sense of connection with rule keeping. And as Maurice Knudsen has so memorably described in his book, The Anti-Group, we know that groups themselves may form a kind of anti-therapeutic stance. And scapegoating, of course, is a kind of basic mechanism by which groups break up, where somebody gets picked on and attacked, and that can often violate the cohesion of a group and attack the kind of formation of a matrix. So if I just tell you a little bit about psychotherapy groups that there have been, again, some of you will be familiar with Fuchs's very interesting idea. And he says this in his 1964 book. It's towards the end. He says how interesting it would be. He doesn't say he's done it, but he says how interesting it would be to run groups for antisocial folk, because together they might form the norm from which they individually deviate. And when I was training as a group analyst, I found that statement very difficult to understand. But after several years of working in forensic settings now, I completely get it. And I have no doubt that Fuchs was right, that there's something about examining the norm, examining the social, and then understanding how people came to let themselves deviate from it or move away from it. As you probably know, the Northfield experiment was all about therapy for people who were breaking the rules. These were soldiers who developed various types of mental health problem, which was keeping them from doing their work as soldiers. And of course, the people who ran the Northfield experiment were themselves kind of rule breakers. The Henderson Hospital became a therapeutic community, again, largely for people with a diagnosis of personality disorder. And many of those had been people who had broken the rules, not all criminal offenders by any means. I've already mentioned H.P. Grendon. And there's a very early paper from 1969, I think, about offering group therapy to mothers who'd killed their children. And more recently, both Estella Weldon and Murray Cox, who I did have the pleasure of knowing when he worked at Broadmoor Hospital, both of these group analysts have written very intriguingly, very interesting, thoughtful, humane papers about group therapy with different kinds of offender. So where are we doing this work? Well, there's other kinds of groups. There's groups in prisons, there's groups in probation, in some forensic mental health services. A lot of groups tend not to be group analytic groups, but tend to be more psychoeducational groups focusing on conscious experience. And that's not a bad thing. That's often really good for helping people get used to the idea of thinking about their minds at all. Because for many of our people, you know, they haven't got that kind of meta-reflective capacity that we take for granted. We do often run therapy groups to help people desist from taking substances. We do CBT, we do dialectical behavior therapy, we do mentalization-based therapy because there's a lot of interest in whether that's helpful for antisocial states of mind. And then we also, there has been a long-standing interest in doing psychodynamic groups, which focus on conscious experience, but also on less conscious processes within the group as well. And we've also tried to run groups which are on the surface, at least, focused on somebody's offence. So we run groups for people who've committed sex offences, and we run groups, in fact, we run a group which is still going, over 10 years now, I'm glad to say, a group for people who've killed a family member. So those men joined that group where the only thing they have in common and the only thing they know about each other is that they've killed a family member. But within that group, everybody is very different and everybody has their own story to tell. And then in UK prisons, since 2013, we've had a specific program for offenders with personality disorder. And prisons have tried to build what are called psychologically informed prison environments, in which they use the idea of mentalizing to help staff think about what's going on for prisoners and help prisoners think about what's going on for them. And as I mentioned to you, the idea of therapeutic communities has been going strong in prisons for over 50 years, but the Offenders with Personality Disorder program has been particularly important in setting up new therapeutic communities in prisons, which tend to use both group dynamic and mentalizing approaches. So what does this work look like? Well, often when we're starting off, we're really thinking, as I said to you, about as therapists, what are we going to work on? What are we going to do? Are we interested in psychological change? Do we want these men to feel better or behave better? Do we want them to move from an antisocial state of mind to a more prosocial state of mind? Do we want to help them process what they've done? Do we want to simply improve their mental health? Do we want to try and move them in their story from being a passive sort of victim of trauma of various sorts, including their own violence, to a more agentic position? Or indeed all of the above. And if we're looking at all of the above, how would we do that? How do we do that technically? How do we do that as co-therapists? What's the best way of doing that? And I'm going to just close, my last few slides are really about why I think groups might be valuable for antisocial folk. So I think that, and I'm saying this without, I'm not trying to idealize groups. Group work can be really difficult and awkward. But I think that when groups are working well, they do have the capacity to promote a social intelligence, which is particularly useful for people who are antisocial. That idea of being curious about other people and feeling interested or empathic in what they're going through. And groups tend to promote debates about social rules. So when somebody breaks the rules, you tend to talk about it in the group, the person who's always comes late or the person who disappears. And just the idea that you could talk about rule keeping without necessarily punishing people or excluding them. Groups look as though they're really good for people who are socially isolated. They're good for people who are grandiose, although the grandiose folk may not enjoy them very much. And they can be very difficult to manage in groups. But groups are really good for shame, because of course, shame is the social experience of believing that other people are looking at you and seeing you, imagining the way that other people see you. And in a group, you can explore that in a way that you simply can't do in individual work. In fact, I increasingly think that individual work is not good for people who are in shameful states of mind. And perhaps a group can provide an identity, somewhere to belong to. So what we learned, what I learned from running this homicide group, was that the men in that group really valued belonging to the group. They found a place where they could belong, where they weren't judged, where what they thought was of great interest, but they were allowed to be who they were. And that belonging enabled them then to take new steps and have new ideas about themselves and what they'd done. So, you know, and in a place like Broadmoor, for example, which is a high security hospital, you know, this is a place which is full of people who've been not been loved and who've acted in highly unlovable ways. So and most offender patients and prisoners are excluded from their community. So you need to belong somewhere, and groups can be good for that. I've already touched on shame, but perhaps groups are particularly good for shame, not only because you can explore what other people think, and people who are in the same position as you who've done equally shameful things, but you might be able to move more into a kind of acceptance of the past and promotion of hope, which is maybe important for future desistance and may be important in building up a kind of resilience. We know that curiosity is an engine of change. But it's easier to be curious about other people if you are securely attached, and curiosity is important for empathy too. So maybe in a group, we can encourage people very gently to try and practice, play with the idea of being curious, you know, of asking questions without necessarily making that question a challenge or a confrontation, but just asking the question. And as I've said, groups mirror social norms in terms of rules. And so it becomes much easier for groups to explore and experience rule breaking within a group. And they can obviously explore the response of group leaders. And you can do reality testing in a group that in a way that is profoundly important for people who've been living in kind of schizoid, paranoid realities of their own making for years. It can be really grounding for people to attach to a group and talk about everyday social realities. And it can provide a kind of containment that way, so that people can ask questions even about psychotic experiences. So we've had people in groups in Broadmoor in particular who've been psychotic, often not all the time, but sometimes for brief periods. And actually, those multiple viewpoints and a capacity to be to kindly tolerate someone who is a bit psychotic has enabled people to feel safer and contain a kind of anxiety. And that's also relevant to people who've been in abusive relationships. That kind of old idea about it might be safer. Interestingly, if you were regularly and routinely abused by one of your parents if you were taken away and abused physically or neglected, or, you know, sitting in a little room with an individual therapist might not necessarily feel like a very safe place to be. And so sometimes with people, when we want to get them into therapy, we put them in small groups first, because it's less arousing for them and they can disappear a bit into the matrix. But of course, people will always be anxious about joining new groups. And so in forensic groups, we struggle with all the same things that everybody struggles with, but tends to be worse. So we find that our forensic folk our offenders, they struggle with engagement. They really, really struggle with engagement. And absenteeism and boundary violations are very common. And because they're anxious, we sometimes get hostility and anger and conflict. And sometimes they avoid the groups because they're very frightened of anger and conflict in groups. And scapegoating is a very common defense. And it's not just in the patients either. It's very easy to blame one patient if a group isn't working very well. And often that patient will be very difficult on the axiom that many scapegoats sort of live up to their identification. You know, some of the guys we work with can be really very difficult, and scapegoating is often a default defense. And we do get people getting very paranoid and trying to turn the groups into gangs. I get a lot of projection outside the group. So blaming the nurses or social workers or doctors or screws. I put victims in there just for completeness, but actually, and we do get people who blame their victims, but you tend to see that more in prisons. But a lot of it is about blaming the staff for their difficulties. And we, as I said, we struggle with sort of unstable idealization and denigration. And that idealization and denigration helps to make people feel a bit more stable. But of course, because it's not reality based, because it's not nuanced, it's not reality based, and because it's not reality based, it's not stable. So it falls away very unstably unstable and increases the anxiety. Now we have some other problems that we get in group work. We get unconscious repetition of index offences, not actual physically acting out. That very rarely happens. But we get, for example, we can get, you know, people will kill off their attendants in the group. Or people who've had very difficult relationships with their parents might have unconscious repetition of problems with the therapists. And pain, the thinking, you know, thinking can be very painful, as Bjorn tells us. And so we can get people trying to stop the process of thinking because it's just too painful. And we have lots of questions, technical questions about whether you can manage people who are also psychotic and how many people, and how many people can you have with severe personality dysfunction? And the answer is really an ordinary groupful, actually, because if you're working in a forensic setting, you don't have any choice about this. So it's a bit different. And actually, people vote with their feet. And what's interesting about forensic groups is that you can offer groups to people, and the people who come will make it work. But it's the people who don't come are the people that we can't reach. They're the people who can't make that shift to consider themselves sufficiently pro-social to join a group. And obviously we're worried about safety and security, although I have to say, famous last words, but that's never been an issue in any of the groups I've been with. And that's partly because of what I just said, is that most people who come to group therapy in a forensic setting want to be there. And of course, you have to learn to work with co-therapists. I personally like working with group therapists, and I'd be used to doing that. But if you're not used to doing that, you have to learn how to do that. And the other thing is, we need to think about the institutions in which we work. Because, for example, if I'm running a homicide group, people who killed family members, that group exists within an institution, a maximum secure psychiatric hospital, which admits very disturbed people who've been very violent when they're mentally unwell. But that forensics high secure hospital exists within a whole network of secure environments for people who are believed to be very dangerous to other people. And they're contained within the wider custodial framework of people who've been identified as violent offenders by the criminal courts and excluded from the wider community by being sent to custodial settings. And they themselves, the criminal courts, represent a subgroup of the wider community, which is thinking about deviance and dissent. But in an institution, from the patient group upwards, we have lots of, you know, concentric groups that are all influencing each other. And all of these groups can get paranoid, and they can all get a bit like gangs when they're anxious. So it's not unusual, for example, for ward teams of staff to get very upset and anxious. And you can get institutional group wars with fights over territory and disputes about resources and people who make alliances and then break them, people who provide protection for vulnerable individuals at a price. And of course, the institutions who are fearful and resistant to change. And I say this because I do quite a lot of reflective practice in various kinds of forensic institutions. And this is probably too big a subject for another day, but I just wanted to flag it up because if any of you are going to embark on a career as therapists working with offenders in forensic institutions, this is a context that is really important to think about. So I just want to end with a quote from our first homicide group. We have two homicide groups, one for people who've killed a family member and one for people who've killed a stranger. So this is about 5 years into the group, I think. Maybe 3 years into the group. Group very well established, a regular group of men. And they often used to start the group by talking about things that they'd watched on television or films. And science fiction was a perennial favorite. We came to kind of have a healthy respect for science fiction as a very useful metaphor for getting people to talk about their minds. And so this is a quote from one of our guys. He'd killed his partner when he was mentally ill and been very, very psychotic at the time, very psychotic subsequently, because he, at least in part, because he was so distressed about it. And he was much better. He was on medication and much better. So he was saying, well, yeah, I've been thinking about Star Trek, about the Prime Directive. And I don't know about you, but when, you know, so what's the Prime Directive? So, well, when they explore a new planet, they're not allowed to interfere with the people there or the culture or to change anything. And, you know, one of the therapists said, well, isn't that what we do here in the group, to explore strange new worlds and boldly go where no one's gone before? And this chap said to the therapist, you do know that I don't actually think we're on the Enterprise. And the poignancy of this is about a man who is making a little joke about being psychotic. That actually it is quite something for a man to be able to make a joke. I mean, jokes with therapists are quite nice anyway in a group. And, you know, there was a lot of laughter in the group at this point. But there was something here for me about a man who'd come so far that he was able to make a distinction between the kind of psychotic thinking which you might be on a spaceship and the kind of thinking that you might play with about that spaceship in a group. And you might, and of course it did take us into a discussion about the strange new world of having killed somebody you love and the new world of life after that, and how you might indeed have to boldly go where you hadn't gone before, and how scary that could be, and how you might need a group to do that. So I'm going to stop there with just a few thoughts, really, that if being lost and socially isolated is dangerous, which we think it is, then groups could be a way to stop people getting lost by giving them something to belong to. And if being hopeless is dangerous, and that is a dangerous state of mind, then groups can promote hope. It's one of the things we know that they can do. And if shame is a risk factor for violence, then groups might be particularly good for people who've done shameful things. And groups might give somebody an opportunity to belong if they don't belong anywhere else. So I'm going to stop there. Dil se tujhko bedili hai, mujhko hai dil ka guru. तू ये माने के न माने लोग मानेंगे जरूर ये मेरा दीवाना मेरा
ye mera di.